Welcome to DM21 Gaming. My name is Bicycle Walrus, and I'm super excited because we got a treat for you today. Joining us today is the creator of Dual Universe, JC Baillie. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing super fine. Thank you for having me on your show. And saying something right away to the community and thank everybody for the amazing thing that happened yesterday. So it happened in the middle of the night for us in France, and we reached that goal. We reached the 500,000 euro goal, and that was amazing. I mean, we were actually we were not hoping, but we were thinking it would happen a bit later. So it went very, very fast, and actually we're on the way now to perhaps reaching the first stretch goal, which is at 600,000. We don't know. I think it's possible to reach it. We will see how things turns out. But we want to say a huge thank you to every backers. This is incredible. And even, I mean, in particular, if you consider that we are not a known company, you know, we have not done another game yet, and we are starting to communicate since the last E3. We don't have a big name with us. We grew this community, this fantastic community, in a super short time. And it's still growing at the moment. So I think this is a good sign about the potential of the game and, more importantly, of the community that is attached to it. So really cool. Thank you. And we are amazed.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I was very concerned for a little bit. I've backed other games in the past. And you know, I really wanted to see Dual Universe made. I've made a couple videos kind of advertising it. But to be honest with you, at this point, the game looks like it's going to happen. Kickstarter funding is there, so congratulations to you. Any other announcements or thoughts before I kind of get into the interview?
Well, thank you to you also indeed for supporting the game. That means a lot. You know, all these people who spoke about it helped to spread the message. And I think, you know, as I said many times, we're trying to realize a very old gamer's dream. Started with me. I mean, I'm the first, the first person who want to play that game. And it's a long story. You know, we have seen a lot of games trying to do it and either failing or disappointing. And I think, we have the technology so that we might be the first one to actually do it and create this game that so many people are waiting for. So this is great. We still have a lot of work ahead of us, a lot of challenges. So this is a first step. We're going to continue, and with your help, you and everybody who is supporting the game, I think we can make it.
All right, fantastic. So you mentioned it, and I think maybe this is a kind of a good jumping off point. You've gotten funding for your Kickstarter, and you basically said it. This is a genre that people really want to see done, and not only do they want to see it done, they want to see it done right, and they want to see it done well. However, Total Biscuit calls this kind of game a, quote, desperation genre. A lot of these games come into early access, and they never actually get finished. And so I guess the question is, what makes Dual Universe different? What makes your team different? What kind of assurances can you give us that we'll get the job done this time with this game?
Well, there are many reasons. First, I may start with that. I mean, the fact that we are building an MMO with a model that is explicitly about having expansions afterwards. It's not like these are going to be patches or things like that that you get after a single player game that is released and that's it, you know, and you have to fix it. No, it's really part of the development of an MMO so that you get new content, new possibilities, you fix some game mechanics over time also. And a good example is EVE Online. They've been doing that for, I think, 12 or 13 years now. And that's exactly the same idea for us. Those expansions are going to be free, so they are completely, you know, actually, you know, it will be required that you upgrade to the latest expansion if you want to play, because you cannot have in a single shard universe, so where everybody is playing in the same world at the same time, you cannot have people running different versions of the game. There's only one reality, right? So expansions will be there, they will be free, and they will add more and more things as time goes on. So, for example, if there is something we cannot do at the initial release, it doesn't mean at all that it is out. You know, it's going to be in the next expansion or the next expansion. So the job for us to communicate clearly about what's going to happen at release, what's going to be in an expansion, why things are, you know, going into an expansion that is sooner or later, and we can explain things like that. So I think the model by which we are going to build the game is helping, I hope, to reassure that the grand vision we have is going to happen as long as we get support from the community and the people playing the game. Of course, I mean, if the game is growing and people like it, so in other words, if we do a good job on the first release, that's going to be very important. Then we will keep having more and more capability to expand the game and also to interact with this community to understand what is the priority. Would you rather have survival gaming, or would you rather have weather or farming, or I don't know. I mean, all these tons of features we are hearing that would make sense, but that we would have to prioritize. So that's one thing. The other thing is the team is fantastic. Really, we have a bunch of extremely talented people. It was hard to build this team. It took quite a lot of time. But we got actually people who I think are totally capable to deliver that. We have people on the technology side that are really, really smart and talented people. That some of them, you know, come from Apple or from big companies like that. They've been working on complex algorithms already before. So I'm talking about people on the, you know, on the server and voxel technologies. So these are the right guys. On the gaming side, we have people who are experienced, who have already shipped many games, so they know what they are doing also. So I'm confident. Well, we could fail. I mean, that's a reality. It's not like we are doing something that is something that you have already seen, you know, 10 times, and somehow you can sort of predict exactly how things are going to happen. We are going into unknown territory. Sometimes, you know, because we're a big fan of sci-fi, so for example, I like Star Trek, like I suppose many of you, and I say, you know, we are on board the Enterprise, and we are going to where nobody has ever gone. And this is exciting. This is something that motivates us a lot. But there's a fair part of risk in that. But, you know, no risk, no reward, and no risk, no new kind of games. I think MMOs needs to be disrupted. MMO needs something new on the scene. So that's what we're trying to do.
That's absolutely fantastic. And so we got this. Now, to be clear, the Kickstarter funding was not necessarily your initial seed funding. And the reason why I'm asking this question is because I think there's a lot of confusion in terms of how business works. So we have this, we had your initial seed funding. You've gotten as far as you have. You're about ready to hit alpha early 2017, correct?
That's the plan, yes.
That's the plan. Okay,
early
fantastic.
Is not what we say. To be precise, what we are saying is we are going to hit alpha in the first half of 2017.
Okay.
So I don't think it makes any sense to say that it's going to happen before March. So that's one thing. Okay. I heard people saying February or things like that. No, it's probably a bit too soon.
Okay.
So that's what we are trying to do.
So more like March, April time frame is what you're thinking.
You know, first half of 2017 is what we will really, really work hard to achieve.
All right, fantastic. This funding that you're getting from Kickstarter, how far along is that going to help you get along? Is that actually going to take you to release?
So that's a fair question, and we have explained already what's going on and the way we see things. As you said, we already have investors, and those guys have helped us to build the technology, you know, the ground on which we are going to build everything else. So this was a big investment already, with the promise of saying, you know, the community is going to support us. This is what player wants. And the Kickstarter is just about actually showing right now, it's showing that we were right, you know, that these investors now have to follow us and keep helping us. And they are going to. I think we are going to see more funding coming from these investors. Some of them actually called me already that they want to reinvest, but in terms that are compatible with the vision of the game. This is, I think, a new way to look at Kickstarter. It's to say that it also can be a way to finance very ambitious projects, so maybe very expensive projects, but by giving already a measurement of the willingness of the players to go that way. And the best measure that investors understand is measure made with the wallet, you know, people voting with their wallets. And that's exactly what's happening at the moment. People are saying, we want that game. And I think this is the way you have to see. I mean, this things with the 500,000 euro, we can go pretty far, but I think we will need more money. So there are different alleys we are going to explore, and we will talk more about that in the near future.
Fantastic. And so, interesting thing is that games that have come before Dual Universe, Crowfall, for example, Star Citizen, now Chronicles of Elyria, they've opened up stores after the Kickstarters have closed. Are you planning on doing the same for Dual Universe?
That's a possibility. So we're looking at this, and the idea is really to say that the Kickstarter is a way, and maybe if we open the store afterwards, a way to make us stronger and more independent from other sources of revenue. The other way of seeing that is that there are different ways to back this game. Investors are going to back because they think there is a market. Players are going to back with smaller amounts, but they are going to back because they want that game. So we're trying to converge those different interests into one direction and to control the direction where it goes. This is the, I mean, suppose we had failed the Kickstarter, what would have happened? Well, I would have tried to find a publisher to get this done because I really wanted it to be done. But the guys would have said, you have to go free to play. You have to put pay to win. You have to simplify. This is too complicated. No, that's what would happen. So the game would have been different. And by saying what we want to do and getting a clear vote with the wallet from the people who are going to be the future customers, we are sending a message, and we make us stronger so that we can say we are right. And that's all what it is about. And, there's a possibility also that indeed we don't need any investor anymore, that we have a community that is so, I mean, look at what happens with Star Citizen. I don't think it's going to happen to us, of course. I mean,
it's $125 million now for them.
Yeah, this is one of a kind, and it has its own logic, and the thing it works will certainly not work for us. These are very different games, in fact, and very different way of financing it, I believe. I mean, so no comparison. But, the only thing we can get from that is that among the player community, there is this potential to support a vision and to support something that is exciting as a gamer. So this potential exists, and if you want, Star Citizen in its way is measuring how intense it is. Probably that's the most intense thing we could ever think having, I suppose. I mean, they have hit the maximum of what could be done. But, even with order of magnitude less support than what they got, we can make this game without any question. And we're going to make it. I just want to reassure everybody that, there are all sorts of options ahead of us. And we are going to make this game. The question is how much independence are we going to get? How much can we say this is the will of the players, this is the directions where we have to go? That's the debate, that's what we're trying to maximize in a sense.
All right, well, let's go ahead and get outside of business and let's get into the game. And I actually had someone send me a question, and it's a very cool technical question, because one of the coolest things that you showed off when you were over I believe at PAX West showing off the game, you were kind of flying people around the solar system, and you even went to the sun, and which is kind of a hot topic because of another game. But the question that he has for you is, it's clearly an open solar system game. If I just flew out into dark space at the correct line of trajectory towards another system, would I eventually get there? Or are there any kind of invisible walls or limitations that would keep you from actually being able to fly there without a gate?
The plan for that is that you should be able to fly to another system. Now, it would take you perhaps something like a week of travel, right? So that's the vision we have. The idea is that the galaxy will be real. There will be a galaxy, and the stars will be there, and you will be able to actually get to those stars. But the time it takes is very long. So if you want to travel, and I'm talking about traveling at warp speed, so you have like a super powerful ship that goes super fast for about 1 week, how much energy does it cost? I mean, can you actually manage the challenge of engineering such a thing? That would be a very interesting question, and people will make it possible, but it will be challenging. That's the point. Now, in the second stage, and that will be clearly in an expansion, not in the release, we are going to introduce stargates, which are basically, you know what the stargate is, right? It's a way to jump directly from one system to the other. But that's going to be player made. It's some organization, because it would be insanely expensive. We'll have to work together to build this stargate. And also, the way the mechanics is going to work is that you need to send a probe first to the destination where you want the stargate to activate, you know, where you want the end of the gate to be. And this probe will take, again, between a week and perhaps a month of real time to get there. And then it will deploy a seed that you can use to do a few jumps to bring the materials and things to actually build your stargate on destination. And then it becomes active, and then it becomes another node in the network of stargates that players will have built. So this means that the size, I mean, there will be a difference between the existing universe, if you want, the playground that exists, and the size of the accessible universe that people will be able to easily travel to, right? So instead of taking a week or a month to fly to another star, you just jump in the stargate and you're there. So that's the vision, you know, that things will take time to expand. It has a lot of benefits also for us that we can actually add more biomes. You know, a biome is like a type of forest or a type of desert or an environment. So we can take this time to develop those biomes and create more and more interesting and strange planets. So basically, for explorers, is the message is the further you go away from the starting planet and the weirdest things you are going to encounter. That's pretty cool. So that's one thing. Stargates also, there will be something that you can let people use for a fee, so it can become a business in the game. You could build, you know, your Stargate, your highway for space, you know, and you have people paying to get access to this network. You could have organizations that have the private Stargate network or things like that. So it's in that respect, it's very different, I think, from most other games. Stargates are not a given. It's something that is part of the emergent gameplay we have in mind. So to summarize, we start with one solar system at release, where you have something like 10 to 20 planets. We don't know exactly that you will be able to explore. Without warp drives, you will have to travel probably for a long time between planets at normal speed. If you want to go fast between planets, you will need this warp technology that allows you to travel at basically the speed of light. And then there's another technological gap, which are stargates, that will allow you to expand to other systems. So that's the idea. And I think it's kind of cool. It's nice to have this technological progress. This game is about, it's not about instant gratification. It's about building achievements and building civilizations together. So the idea that you will need several months of playtime to build things, we think this is a good idea. It fits with the vision of an MMO that you play on long periods of time. This is not a single player game where you have to get everything that you could possibly get in the game within 10 hours or something like that. So that's the vision.
All right. So you mentioned build times, because one of the very favorite things to do is build that ship, and it takes you a matter of what? I think one of the testers who actually came to your event in France was able to build one in about a minute and a half and took off. So how complex is that building system going to become to create that engineering challenge that would take a couple weeks in order for you to build something
All right.
neat, cool, or different?
That's a very good question, because it allows us to, you know, it allows me to stress the idea of what we call systemic gameplay, that you have different players doing different things and they interact with each other, for example, through the in-game markets. And that allows to change completely how long it takes to do something. So to be clear, if you start from nothing at all and you have to gather all the materials and to build all the 3D printers, the assemblers, basically to rebuild your own industrial complex, right? And then you are going to slowly build the parts that are necessary to construct the different engines and the cockpit and everything. And you start to build your ship like that. It's going to take a long time because you are going to start from nothing and all by yourself. You have to rebuild the whole industrial complex to get to the possibility for you to build a spaceship. Now, if you imagine that you are in a game with other players, which is exactly what it's about, you could very well shortcut a lot of those things. You could go on the market and buy the engines already. And so you have them in a matter of minutes, right? And then it's all about assembling those things. Here again, I mean, you could assemble the things, work on the Lua scripting yourself and do a lot of things that would take you a fair amount of time. So if you like that, if it's fun, it's good. But you could shortcut that also by having the script automatically generated by the auto configurator, which is something that will look at your ship and produce a script that works for you. That does, you know, the basic piloting, right? So that could be quite fast. Well, you still need to have, you know, the basic things that you have seen in the demos, you know, some reservoir for the fuel, connecting the engines. We are not yet sure how we're going to physically do the connecting, you know, whether you have to plug things or not. So this is a degree of simplification that could happen or not. But apart from that, it could be quite fast once you have all the different ingredients. Especially also if you have done already a lot of ships, so you know how it works, it's getting faster. So you see, the answer to the question, how long does it take to build a ship, will depend on, you know, where you start from, how far you are from a market where you could buy everything you need. How big is your ship? Is it going to be complicated, or is this just a simple ship as the one we have shown in the demonstrations? So this will factor into whether your ship can be done in, yes, 3 to 5 minutes, or whether it takes you 3 months because, you know, you're building a super cruiser, huge, massive ship. And, I mean, there are hundreds of people involved. And we're talking about a huge player-driven quest, if you want, right? Something that will attract a lot of people on that. So, you know, this is an interesting question because it shows that there is no single answer to that. It's not like we have designed a game with a predefined path so that a single player guy can do a ship in that amount of time. It's more complicated, more interesting, I think.
All right. So this is kind of the question I kind of wanted to start with, because it's always a good launching point for, you know, how you actually expect the game to play. And these types of games, they're so large in scope. There's so many different things I suppose you could go out and do in Dual Universe. But what would you imagine your personal playstyle, so talking about you, what would a day in the life of JC be in Dual Universe post-release?
Okay, well, I was a big player of EVE Online and Minecraft. So I think the kind of gameplay that you have in EVE Online will not be there at start immediately because you need a critical mass of, you know, ships and political structures and territorial structures and so on. I would focus probably on building first. I would go and build stuff. So I would probably build some kind of, not a castle, but I mean an outpost, something that would be super cool. And I would spend a lot of time fine-tuning this thing. I would probably try to secure a territory within the safe zone so that I can build these things in complete peace, so I'm not worried. The safe zone is pretty large. It's going to be at least 20 kilometers in radius. We could make it even bigger, actually. We would see. And with 20 kilometers, you already have 1,000 tiles, you know, that are basically available to claim. It would take time, by the way, also to do that because you don't have a territory unit, and a territory unit is something quite complex to craft. So maybe I would start to basically start to mine a little bit and collect the materials so that I could do this territory unit, secure the territory, start to build my my outpost, and maybe look at also at all the organizations that are already advertising. Have you seen? I mean, it's fantastic. This also is amazing. If you go on the community website we have launched, it's called community.jewelthegame.com, We've launched that about 3 months ago, and there's already close to 900 organizations already declared there that are, I mean, some of them are absolutely amazing in the amount of things they are stating about what they want to do, the way they want to organize themselves, what is their in-game vision. So I would probably spend a whole evening just watching on this site, you know, looking at these different organizations and figuring out whether I want to join one of them. Most likely I would have done that before, because, you know, this is happening right now. You can already join an organization on this website. So, and then in the game, I could just connect to these guys and join whatever plans you know, they have, whether they want to build a Death Star, or if they want to become a huge industrial superpower, or other goals like that, or pirate groups. So there would be a lot of possibilities that would come from the community itself, not only me. That's very important to understand. Again, we are not in a single player game, and that changes everything. You have all these things happening, and you can decide to get involved, or you can decide to lead it. You can become a leader of one big project within the game, and you rally people to your project. So, you know, it's a bit like, you know, in real life, entrepreneurs, if you want to build something big, you go and you try to attract people to your project. Something like that would be also possible. So, yeah.
All right. So we see cities being built in the first trailer you came out with.
Yep.
And, you know, I hear a lot about mining and building and exploring. What is life going to be like for a city dweller? Why would you want to be a city dweller?
I think the interesting question is, why do we think that there could be cities emerging? That's a fair question. Part of a more generic question of, you know, if we dream of having this kind of advanced sci-fi civilizations that has this huge imperial capital cities and all of that, I mean, what do we do in general to influence the way the content is going to happen so that it goes into the right direction? It's a complex, almost science, you know, trying to understand the underlying principles that leads to the emergence of things like that. And you have to look also at how it is happening in the real world. I think this is a great source of inspiration. So, for example, in the Middle Ages, people gathered into cities and started to build huge walls to protect themselves. That is a pattern you see everywhere. This happened in every culture, everywhere. So that you protect together, you build a protection against potential, thieves or pirates, I would say, that would be outside. So I think the same thing could happen. As soon as you want to establish yourself permanently outside of the safe zone, you're going to have to think about protection. The way we see this is going to be probably with protection bubbles, so some kind of, you know, bubbles that you can spawn wherever you want, that will require a lot of energy, that will cost a lot of in-game money to build. Quite naturally, I think this will attract people together under this bubble. So there will be, for example, an organization that says, let's do a bubble. And of course, let's build everything we do within the bubble. You know, and that's exactly like the Middle Age village that creates a big wall around it, right? It's the same idea. So because it's dangerous outside of the safe zone, if you want to establish something permanent quite far away from it, you will probably get through this process of having things concentrated. And then you mutualize your strength, your resources, so that you can build a super strong protection bubble. That's one mechanism. The other reason also is that, you know, a lot of people are role-playing and a lot of people simply want to do that. No more, I mean, you don't need to have more reasons than that also. A lot of things will happen because it's cool. Why would people build a huge space stations? Well, because that's something you will need to build a market that stores huge amounts of goods that are traded. This is the, you know, the gameplay logic. But I think even without that, people will want to build huge space stations because it's cool. So, but these are, you know, the two kind of answers, you know, coolness and also gameplay reasons that we try to nudge people into certain directions.
Well, the gameplay reasons are definitely understood, and I think that's where a lot of people would go into city building, is to protect common resources and things like that. But I guess on the cool side of the equation, any kind of support for social functions? You mentioned role players. What about things like building a nightclub or a bar? Will there be drinking mechanics? You know, and the reason I ask this, again, it's I hear a lot of questions that I get from Q&As on other games that are sandboxy, open world, much like this, and they're curious about social features. I mean, these are important to gamers based on what I hear.
Okay, well, it's not in the roadmap that we have at the moment, but it definitely sounds like a very good idea. And it means that it is a very good candidate, I think, for an expansion. We would call it, you know, the social expansion or something like that, where we put a lot of those ideas and we focus, you know, for 6 months into developing those things because the community is asking for it. So these kind of features, you know, there are these kind of features that we look at them and we say, does it make or break the game? I mean, do we need those things for the game to exist? Is it fundamental? Is it going to be something you cannot do without? The answer is clearly no. We could have a very good game without this thing. So for this reason, we will everything like that, you know, will be pushed to further expansions and not to release. We have already so much things to do, you know, for, until the release. We want to be very careful, and we want to say people, okay, this is not a feature that is fundamental for the game to work, so let's do it afterwards. Maybe it makes it to the release if we have enough time, you know, that is a possibility. But we could not prioritize these things because it's not part of the recipe we have in mind. The minimal set of features, if you want, that will set the game in motion. But definitely, as an expansion, excellent idea, and we are going to listen to all the feedback of the community. We already are doing that, so that we can understand what is the priority of our players, you know, not you know, investors or what I said before.
All right. So we talked a little bit beforehand, and I was going to mention creatures and things like that as part of this interview, and you pretty much had the same answer. This seems like one of those things that might come as an expansion later on. So
there will be creatures at start, a minimal set, so that you have a sense of a living world, right? That I think this is necessary. Sure. Whether it's going to be turned into you know, a real gameplay, I don't think so, because, you know, some games have made their whole point about making that good, right? So if you come up with something that is half cooked and not very good, people will not like it, and it will not bring any value to the game. So better, you know, delay it probably. So it's not like it's going to be empty. There will be things, but whether you can make a gameplay out of it, like hunting the things or farming them or things, probably not.
Okay, so this sounds like an awful lot like, basically, you guys want to put things into the game that obviously makes sense with the universe and what you're trying to build, but you're also going to kind of reserve yourself to putting things in the game that can be polished and done right.
Yeah. You know, the important things are all the things we have put in the 500,000 goal, a basic goal. You know, what is important is that you have a market, because that's the way you can have player specialization. That's how you could specialize into doing certain things and sell the result of that against in-game money that you can use to buy all the other things you don't want, for example, you don't want to do. This is the fundamental mechanism of the systemic approach I was talking about. So market, yes. Territory, probably fundamental also, so that, you know, people can build their home. This is an important feature. Combat, at least avatar versus avatar, is important. We need at least to test these dynamics. You cannot switch from a game that is completely peaceful to suddenly a game with combat. This might actually disrupt completely things. So, you know, these are very important features, and there's a list of them on the Kickstarter page that are part of what defines the game. If you take one of those out, it's not easy to put it afterwards. It's very difficult. So we're going to focus on that first.
Okay. So I'm going to ask a bunch of questions about PvP, because this definitely does seem like a very PvP-oriented game, everything from economics to, you know, controlling territory to protecting your, maybe even trademarks and things like that. But before I get into that, for those people who just want to play it safe, who just want to stay in the safe zone forever, will those people be able to go out and explore space and do some of the more... I guess PvE aspects of the game without fear of being interfered with via PvP?
Well, the stepping out of the safe zone doesn't mean that you're going to be ganked by pirates immediately. One of the reasons, for example, that we believe that this is going to be something less dangerous that you would have in other games is simple things. Like, for example, if you take EVE Online, I'm sure most people are at least a bit familiar with it. You have those stargates that connect different systems that have different levels of security. So let's say you are in the safe zone, you want to go into the non-safe zone, you have to go through one of those stargates. And there's a very particular specific point in space where you have to go through, right? And that's exactly where pirates are going to wait for you. So there's a bottleneck that makes it extremely dangerous to do the journey. And once you're out, what you see in EVE Online is that, well, in zero-zero space, in certain cases when there's no war or anything, well, you could be pretty much at peace. You know, if you're okay. The thing is the bottlenecks. Right? And in our case, for example, the safe zone is about, as I said, 20 kilometers large. That is close to about 100 kilometers of frontier, you know, the perimeter of the circle, if you want. And you can just not control 100 kilometers of frontier with a bench of three guys. So it makes the notion of bottleneck disappears, basically. So, and if you add the fact that you can also step out of the safe zone by going underground, and I don't know what, I mean, the scale of the things are going to make this much more difficult for people to wait for anybody to step out of the safe zone. Now, if you step out of the safe zone, you can also use a ship with a shield. That can be a very powerful shield. It's not like you're going to be blown out immediately from the first guys showing up. We could have also things like invisibility cloaks that will protect you from being an easy target. So we will add things that will make it possible to step out of the safe zone with most of the time being okay. So this is the trade-off we are thinking about. There will be also other safe zones that will unlock as time goes on. Probably that will be a motivation for explorer, you know, to find, let's say, ancient ruins, to simplify. But we will talk about exactly how it goes. But let's say an ancient ruin you find, and that helps you to deploy a new safe zone in another part, either on the main planet or at least on another planet. We will see, you know, how many safe zones per planet. These things we need to balance as we do the alpha and beta testing. But anyway, there will be other safe zones. So you could hop from one point to another into relatively safe areas. Now, if you want to mine the cool stuff that are bringing a lot of money, you will have to go outside of a safe zone, quite obviously. So these are the things, you know, if you just want to build, and you're a builder, for example, you really don't need to go outside the safe zone. You can buy everything you need to build from the in-game markets, and you could trade your skills as a builder to get that money. So it's possible that you never have to step out of it. And even if you do, I don't think it's going to be such a cutthroat environment as people think, because we are going to be careful to make it, challenging. For people to actually attack others without warning or without any reasons. There will be a bounty system also that we are still thinking about, that we are making such that the aggression of somebody who is not, who's basically a peaceful player, is going something you will have to think twice before doing. So we will make these kind of mechanics so that people can enjoy PvP, but also enjoy non-PvP lifestyle, if you want.
All right, fantastic. I got one more question about PvE before moving into PvP, and that is, I'm a big fan of Firefly. I'm sure many people watching are probably big fans of Firefly. I know there's going to be pirates from players. But is there any kind of nemesis like the Reavers or just some, you know, distant, far out in space kind of nemesis that will track you down and find you or something like that if you become a deep space explorer or any kind of like villain that's a PvE encounter?
That's a total possibility in the long run. This is something that, that we could decide to add. It's not going to be in the first release because it involves all sorts of development that I don't think we will have time to do. But we hear the community about this point. And we have to take care also of the backstory. We have a backstory that I think is pretty interesting. So whatever PvE we add should actually fit with that. It has to also to be, I mean, we have this world that is built by players. It would not be fair to suddenly have a swarm of aliens showing up and destroying everything for no reason. So it has to happen in certain circumstances, in certain parts of the universe. So basically, you know, the principle is that you should be able to understand and to control the level of threat you're going to face in whatever you do. So we have to be careful that, you know, somebody who is didn't ask for anything, you know, is not suddenly without any reason attacked or things like that. So this is clearly something that people want, so we are looking into it. But I don't think we can make it for the initial release. That's unlikely.
All right, no problem. So the next question, now we're going to get into PvP. Building things is a huge part of this game. Building things up. However, we see in games like Ark Survival Evolved, where sometimes what took 10 people a week to build, 3 people can break it apart in an hour. So my question would be, what kind of balance are you looking for in that? If me and 10 of my buddies spend a week to build something, how easy would it be for someone to come along and then tear it apart?
It won't be easy, and so the destruction is going to be something that requires a lot of efforts and firepower. But of course, there will be some people who have that firepower or this motivation on the sheer numbers to break mostly anything in a short time. I'm not talking about protection bubbles, by the way, because those things will be a huge barrier that protects your things from whatever is inside. And we are thinking about, you know, mechanisms that once they are destroyed, they enter into a reinforced mode that lasts for example, let's say 48 hours, that during which they become indestructible. And so you have a lot of time to react to what happens. But anyway, the answer to your question is we will make sure that, you know, no information is ever lost. So if you build something, there will be snapshots that happens all the time to save, you know, the state of whatever you're building, the state of your construct. And those snapshots will be, it's a bit like blueprints, but the difference is that a blueprint is something that you can sell on the market, that you can use in a factory to make several copies of your stuff. So a blueprint is a gameplay item. It's something that is part of the reality of the game. The snapshots are more, let's say, something that is on your computer, you know, some save, autosave that happens. And even if your stuff is destroyed, you will have either the possibility, if it's not completely annihilated, you will have the possibility to rebuild it with a repair unit, which is an element you can deploy with, if you put it the right you know, materials and the right energy to do it, it's going to rebuild your stuff. And if you don't have anything left, then you can basically rebuild it from your snapshot and it will do the same. Again, you need to get the materials back and everything that was part of your construction. So it turns out it's about a bit of time to get either the money to buy them on the market or to go mine the stuff you need yourself, but never about losing information. You know, this careful design you have made for weeks, this is never going to be lost. So, and of course, if you really want to be safe, you could stay inside the safe zone and this will never happen. So there's different levels of risk you can take, but if you are outside of a safe zone with a good protection bubble and you have all these snapshots mechanism going on, well, you know that there's a risk, but the thing is, if it happens, it's not the end of the world. You can rebuild things. So I think this is a good trade-off. Never lose any information. You know, information is what comes from your brain and you put into the game. This is safe. And I think that's the most important thing. It could actually almost be fun that after an attack you have to rebuild. You know, that sets sort of a set of goals. You know, let's rebuild our stuff and let's get our revenge. You know, could even be something okay and nice in the game as part of emergent gameplay.
All right, next question I have for you is, if I were to log out, would my avatar remain in the game or would my avatar disappear?
You are not allowed to log off.
This
is a permanent game. Once you step in, you always stay in it forever.
Oh.
No, I'm joking. So when you log off, your avatar is going to disappear. It's going to probably stay for a few minutes, so you cannot use log off as a way to escape an attack easily. But it will disappear, your avatar. Your constructs obviously cannot disappear. If you think about a giant, imperial palace, and the guy, you know, logs off and poof, it's not there in the landscape anymore. It would break immersion. It could not make sense, right? So your stuffs are still there. However, whatever is in your character inventory is preserved. Whatever is in the container within the safe zone is preserved. So there will be a lot of things that make sure that you are not worried about what's going to happen. And yeah, that's it. So your character is basically disappearing. You don't see it anymore in the world.
Okay. All right.
Is that answering your question? Or?
I'm a little concerned right now because I'm curious if I need to check myself into a hospital prior to logging into your game. I need to be able to log out. That does answer my question. So you'll be logged. Your avatar will disappear a few minutes afterwards. And so
we were thinking also about allowing people to sleep, but there's a problem because the time is uniform for everyone. So if you go to sleep, you cannot accelerate time, for example. So the things like that. You have the problem in Minecraft when you play multiplayer. When somebody goes to sleep, everybody has to go to sleep, right? Otherwise, you don't get the speed up.
All right. I'm going to ask a couple yes or no questions.
Okay. I'm trying to do that.
Kind of go through a bit of a speed round here. And okay. I'm not trying to do a gotcha thing. I'm just trying to see if we can get a few questions out there and sure. Just get some basic answers there, all right?
Let's do it.
First question. Can you destroy a planet?
No.
All right. Next question. Can a species go extinct?
We don't have species at the moment, so I mean, I cannot answer that question.
Okay.
Probably no, because that would, waste a lot of our efforts and work as artists who have designed this species, right? Unless we have some procedural generation, but I don't think it's going to happen.
Are resources finite?
Yes. Finite, they don't regenerate, but there will be many of them on many, many planets, and planets are very, very big. So just people to understand that, a kilometers long vein of something is a huge amount, millions of cubic meters of stuff. There will be plenty of a lot of things, and it will be more and more in different planets.
All right. Will you be able to land on asteroids?
Yes.
Will there be asteroid mining?
Yes, and you know what? Well, look at today's update. That's all I can say.
Okay. What about space walking?
Space walking?
Yes. So, for example, I mean, my ship was damaged. I need to exit my ship and repair it while in space.
Yeah, sure. Yes.
All right. And will there be... And this might be a long-form question, but in the middle of that spacewalking, will there be significant risk to my character, like sort of a survival mechanic involved in the process, or will it be kind of simple?
Probably not at a release, but that's a nice game mechanics to introduce afterwards so that you have to care about the equipment you wear and there are some consumables that may limit the time you can step out and things like that. Obviously, that's something that would make a lot of sense, yes. But not at release, I think. We won't have time, I think.
Okay. If a player can figure out how to do it, can he control the orbit of a planet around a sun?
No, because planets are not going to orbit around the sun.
Oh, okay. So the planets... Because we've seen this where the sun moves, so the planets aren't orbiting?
No. I mean, what we have done in the demo is indeed we move the sun, and what we intend to do is to have the planets rotating on their axis, but they cannot revolve around the sun, because you could have an, you know, ships on the trajectory that would collide with the planet as it moves, which means that on the server we would have to handle potentially millions of collisions with all those planets. I mean, it's just a lot of load for no benefit in gameplay. I mean, it doesn't bring anything fundamental, I think, to the game. So planets are static, but they will probably, unless we encounter technical issues with that, but they will probably rotate around their axis. So day-night cycle.
So the planets will rotate on their axis. Okay. Fantastic. I thought I saw the sun moving at one point in one of those videos, and I was like, oh, that's cool.
Yeah, the sun, in these videos, the sun is moving. It's the sun. We just move the sun. That's an easy way to show, you know, the visual effect of what happens with the day-night cycle.
Got yes. it.
That's right. Not the way it's going to be in the game. Or if, I mean, that would be the default case. If we cannot have the planets rotating on their axis, we will fall back to turning the sun or something like that. But that would be weird. And we'll try to avoid that.
Fantastic. Will I get lost in this game?
Yes. Well, there's a possibility that, yes, you could be in a ship that doesn't have any fuel anymore and you're in the middle of nowhere and you don't have any friend. And I mean, this is an extreme case where you just are going probably to auto-destruct and get back to either the Ark ship or your nearest resurrection node.
So it's probably the unfortunate fate of Captain Twerkmortar when he runs out in the middle of dark space and, you know, and yeah. his quest to go to another system.
But I mean, this is I mean, I don't think it's going to happen. You will have some friends. You will have even if you don't have any friend, you can always make a call for help, and some guys will show up. Maybe for good or for bad, depends who is going to show up, right? But I mean, this is something you will be able to play, to role play. I think it's cool. It's not a problem, I think. It's cool.
All right. So we got a few more minutes left, and so I wanted to get back into some more of the business sense. So you guys are going to have a monthly subscription, and that will be paid for with these tickets. I forgot what you guys called them. I can't remember off the top of my head.
DAC, but it's not necessarily paid with DAC. So glad you're asking, because I will be able to clarify a lot of things, I suppose. Yes. I let you finish. Sorry.
Basically, I know you can pay the monthly subscription, or you can purchase that item from another player in the game using in-game money. Would you care to explain that system? Because I see a lot of questions scrolling in chat about it, and a lot of people seem confused even after having their questions answered by other people. So,
That's that's the weakness of this business model. I think it's not that it is something you have to pay monthly or. People, sometimes complain about that. The problem is that it's hard to understand exactly how it works. I mean, it's not complex. It's just that, you know, it's not very usual. Well, short answer, if you know EVE Online, it's very similar to the Plex system that they have. So a DAC is an item that exists physically in the game that you can buy from Nova Quark, and that appears then in your inventory. And that you can do two things. Either you turn it into 1 month of playtime, which the people who buy them will not do most of the time, but you can also sell them on the in-game market. So the thing is that you could turn a bit of money that you pay to acquire this item to us and turn it into in-game money. So it's a way to bootstrap yourself into the game and get a bit of money. And on the other side of the equation, you have some more veteran or more active player that is capable to generate enough of in-game money every month from its game activities that will go every month on the in-game markets and buy this DAC at whatever the price it is. This is an important point, that the price is fluctuating. It depends on the market supply and demand. But whatever the price, if it's affordable for him or her, he's going to go on the market and buy it. And then he is going to turn this item into 1 month of playtime. So effectively, he's going to play for free. So it's, if you think about it, it's the exact opposite of the free-to-play model. The free-to-play model, it's free to start in the game. And then once you really get passionate about the game, you start to be paying. In our case, it's the opposite. You start in the game by paying your subscription. And fairly quickly after, I don't know how fast, but I mean, at some point, If you are active enough in the game, if you're really passionate about it, you will be able to play for free. So we reward the most active players basically by having them playing for free. So that's very important mechanism to understand. Now, you know, this subscription model, I think, is also a way to guarantee that the population of players that are in the game are really committed to it. So it's a way, in a sense, to increase the quality of the community that you get inside this game. You don't have tourists that come there, just free to play, and they just destroy everything, or I don't know what. So it's a way to say, to filter by the motivation. Again, it's a bit of like voting with your wallet, so that you get into this game because you really want to play it. And you know all the problems with the free-to-play models about some toxic players that are ruining the experience of everybody else, right? And this is considerably lowered because of this business model. So instead of thinking, oh, I will have to pay every month, first of all, you probably won't do that. You will buy a bundle for 6 months or 12 months. That will be very comparable. And if you think about, let me give you an idea of a price. Let's say 59.9 euros for 6 months of game time, right? Something like that. This is going to be the price of a AAA game that you could, is comparable to the price of a AAA game. A AAA game is like 20, 30 hours of fun if you're lucky. Rarely you get some amazing games, you know, that gets you hundreds of hours. But I mean, really, it's not what happens. And so if you look at that, you're going to pay about 60 euros and you get 6 months of fun. You can play every day. So, I mean, economically, if you have a budget for your games, this makes a lot of sense. It's not something that is unacceptable. And it creates this community of people who are committed that will reward afterwards by saying, you know, you can play. It's possible that you can play for free if you're very active in the game. I played a lot of EVE Online, as I said, many years without paying anything. You know, and I because I was trading on the in-game markets and making money with doing that on the side, you know. So this is a reality that we have this model that I think is perfectly fit to create a community that are here to build these civilizations together into this virtual world. And I think this is the right choice. Now, we will see, you know, the ultimate answer to that will be, the market response. But I think it's a model that is mostly not very well understood. There's a lot of reactions that are like reflexes, like, we don't want that. But we have all those servers also to maintain. We will also provide quality support to people. So we have a nice model that, the number of people, the more people we have in the game, the more money we make, so the more support we can finance. So there is no distortions between the whales who are paying more and those who are not. Everybody is equal. This is another element of this business model. Everybody that enters the game is equal. Everybody is treated the same. And there's a lot of things like that. You know, this business model is sound, and it's not necessarily well understood. So we will keep trying to explain. One thing also, because some people saw the price of DAX, that is a price we have in mind for the time coupon I mentioned, right? And they assume that this is the price of the subscription. It is not the case. In this model, if you look at EVE Online also, the price of the time coupon you buy from Nova Quokka are more expensive than the price of the subscription for many reasons. But the point is that the subscription, as we said, we announced it, that it's going to be between 10 and 13, euros per month, or dollars, right? So it's not 18 euros. Some people are worried about that. It would be, you know, out of proportion. We are looking at the market, of course, and that's not what is done. So something like that. And most likely people will buy them in bundles. And the reasoning is, you know, how many hours of fun do I get for that amount of money? Does it make sense in my budget for gaming? And we hope that the answer is going to be, oh, yes, clearly it is. So, voilà.
All right. I know we're very short on time right now. Do you have time for two more questions?
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, I was a bit long on this one, but it's a very important point, I suppose.
Oh, no, absolutely. And, you know, there's a reason why you have so many questions, and it was definitely a question that needed to be asked. So this is still on deck. Moving on. Plex created a system in which ISK actually had real world money value. And people were actually running entire businesses and supporting their livelihoods on Plex and ISK. So my question is more or less, do you see something similar happening in Dual Universe? Would that be incentive for someone to take the game super seriously?
You know, maybe I'm missing something, but how do they actually convert the ISK into real money? Because that's not allowed and not possible. And so, because the way it goes is only one way, you see. So you cannot just take your ISK and sell them. If you do that, actually, if you do that as a business, what happens is that you're going to be a competition to the other market that is the legal market of buying the time coupon from Nova Quark, right? And so what happens when you have two markets in parallel like that, they tend to equilibrate. Because, you know, if you're more competitive than what we do at Nova Quark, people will tend not to buy from us anymore and buy from you. And so not buying from us will impact the market supply and demand and will lower the price. And, you know, at some point, they tend to actually converge. It's not a perfect, you know, thing because there are a bit of friction, but they tend to converge. And then as a player, you have a choice at some point. You know, for the same price, you could get your in-game money from the regular Nova Quark supported system or from a shady sort of, you know, like say a Chinese farmer or things or something like that. What would you do? Obviously, you go to Nova Quark. Even if there's a small price difference, most people will tend to go to Nova Quark. I don't say it cancels completely real money trade, but it has a very negative effect on it. In other words, as a real money trader, you will pick your games based on profitability. And I think the conversion mechanisms we have for DAX, so the time coupon, is actually making this kind of game like EVE Online or what we're trying to do, so Dual Universe, is going to be very not competitive. So maybe I'm missing something. Maybe you know more than me on that, but I don't think there's a clear way. There's a clear way to transform your ISK into real cash.
It's not necessarily ISK to cash. It's more or less ISK to Plex than to cash. Basically, there was an article written up on USA Today about how someone lost so much money. Actually, he had so many Plex in his cargo, he was blown up. This was before you could trade Plex. This was before the systems where you could trade Plex from any system. But he got blown up and he lost X number of dollars that he was planning on selling in order to buy a car.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, we are thinking, and we announced a few things on that, you know, ways to protect your DAX. So that, you know, they cannot be destroyed like that. So this is we understand that there's a real money aspect to it, and that you know, we have to make sure that this is not like just any other item. But this is a sensitive topic, I would say. So we're listening to the community on that, and there will be mechanisms that allow you to make sure that you are not wasting this amounts of money by mistake.
All right, and for the last question, scripting your ships and things like that, I think that's one of the coolest features, and not many games are taking advantage of it. I know that Chronicles of Elyria is allowing you to script your offline player character and things like that, but we know we can script things like a cockpit interface, and we can build things. Can I build an android and program its AI?
Well, building an android in the way, you know, the building is working in Dual Universe would mean that we introduce ways for you to make very small size joint elements that would connect different parts of voxel, so you could start to make limbs and things like that, right? This is something we would like to do, and it's not going to happen in the release also, but we are thinking about it. It's I think technically quite feasible, and so why not? So that you will have this kind of robots, and then the script will, of course, will be there to control the gate, you know, the way the different movements are coordinating to make your things move around and so on. Now we could very well have some intermediary things where you don't build physically, you know, the Android, but we have a sort of entity like a pet that you could program to some extent, or you could have a flying sort of drone construct that follows you and that accompanies you, things like that. This will be possible. So, I mean, at least the construct side, the pets, the fact that you could program them, this is something we could do. I really don't know. We will think about it. But it's mostly at the moment, I think it will be more like, you know, some kind of construct that flies and follows you that you can program in any way you want to to follow certain targets or to go to certain points. The only limit, you know, to scripting is that it should not break other game mechanics. For example, if you do automatic mining via scripting, there's a good chance that you're going to break completely the mining gameplay for normal players, right? Because it will become so inefficient that nobody's going to do that. So instead of having a mining gameplay, it will become a scripting for mining gameplay, because nobody who has any sense, I mean, would do anything else but scripting the mining, right? So this we don't want, because mining should be something that you can start with as a new player. So it's important to maintain it. And so we are going to put some limits to how much you can automate with scripting based on that consideration that the activity should remain something that players want to do. One way of maybe preserving that is to make the scripting extremely, extremely significantly less efficient than whatever a normal human would do, for example. But then people might actually start to over-script so that you have huge amounts of things to compensate for the efficiency drop. So not clear this is the right direction. That's kind of limits we will have, not for technical reasons, but for gameplay reasons into what we can script.
So we don't have to worry about Skynet taking over Dual Universe, because there'll be limitations in what you could script.
Well, let me think about it. You know, I come from AI and robotics, actually, right?
Uh-huh.
So this is something I know about. My previous company, we used to build robots, and people were always asking us whether we were doing Terminators. And now, you know, I'm waiting because I suspect people will ask me whether we do The Matrix, right? That's
yes.
The next thing.
You know, I'm growing very concerned about the number of Sword Art Online references we're making today. But now, I have to ask, are you familiar at all with the Gundam anime series?
I know it. I'm not familiar with it.
I'm wondering if we can make giant mechanized warrior biped machines and fly into space and things like that.
That's the same. That's the same question. I mean, related to the same thing I just said before.
Yeah.
Do this. It's technically, I think it's possible to implement something like that, but it's a lot of work. It's a lot of new tech challenge again to get this right. It's about having a construct in which certain elements, you know, there are joints that can move, so you could control those angle, for example, with a script, right? And the other thing is that from this joint, you could stick some other parts of a voxel that you could build. So it's like two constructs that would be joint with a joint, right? And so there's a lot of technical issues. I'm not going to talk about it now, and it's a very long thing. But I mean,
sure,
this would be the direction to go, probably by limiting the size of the voxel that you can stick, so you could make some small things animated. It goes also for having doors that could open, you know, or bridges that goes down. All those things would come from that. We're thinking about it. Definitely not in release, but really that could be a very, very nice expansion. We'll
Transformers.
See in the future. Yeah, very, very cool. And that could be really nice. The only question, you know, is server load. You know, making this work with potentially thousands of people in the same area, you know, this is our challenge. It makes everything much more complicated. So people should keep in mind, you know, that what they see in a single player or in a not so massively multiplayer game where you have a few hundreds of people, together, cannot necessarily be translated in the context of a single shard like Dual Universe. So we have to sacrifice certain things to get this super nice feature that is that we all live into the same world that keeps growing, developing with its own history. This is fantastic thing, and we are ready to abandon certain things, at least for the moment. You know, technology is progressing. Who knows in, you know, if we're still there in 10 years, yeah. Maybe we will have quantum computers and, you know, the power we can unleash on that will be amazing. But, you know, we're in 2016. The game's going to be out at the end of 2018 if everything goes as planned. And, you know, this is the kind of tech constraints we have so far.
Well, I'll tell you what, I could ask questions to you all day, but we are now out of time. And thank you so much for being generous with your time and actually coming here on our show and answering a lot of questions that I know a lot of people are kind of dying to know the answers to. So thank you very much again to our audience. This is JC, the creator of Dual Universe. And again, what a pleasure it was to have you.
Thank you. What a pleasure, too. Thanks.
All right, guys, my name is Bicycle Walrus. This is DM21 Gaming. Stay tuned as we will continue our coverage of Dual Universe now that it's a thing and its Kickstarter has succeeded. Thank you so much for watching. My name again is Bicycle Walrus. This is DM21 Gaming, and we'll see you guys next time.